The following program was made possible by the generosity of those who have determined to hold fast to the true Roman Catholic religion, as expounded by the Roman Catholic Church before the disasters of Vatican II and the so-called New Mass.
Hello and welcome to What Catholics Believe. I'm your host, Thomas Nagley, and with me tonight are three traditional Catholic priests, all from the Society of St. Pius V. We have, of course, Father Jenkins from right here in Cincinnati. We have Father Thomas Mroczka from Minnesota. And to my left, we have Father Martin Skierka, all the way from Montana, visiting us right here in Norwood, Ohio. Hello, Reverend Fathers. Welcome to the program. How are you all doing?
Great. Fine, Tom. Thank you. How are you?
Yeah, great. Great. It's good to see you all. Yeah, great to be here with you all. Thanks for coming.
Congratulations on your new boy.
That's right. Thank you. Thank you, Father. Finally had our first son after four tries. God has finally blessed us with the son. So we have
four girls.
Four girls, yes.
And they're all wonderful.
Yes. Yes. Just like their mother.
Absolutely.
Well, Reverend Fathers, I thought that we could have an interesting discussion tonight based on an email that we received from one of our viewers in England, actually. And so I'll read through a bit of his email here and get your reaction to some of this. He says that my wife and I, this viewer says, we're having a discussion of the future of our children and the stark reality that they face growing up in a world which is rapidly and aggressively seeking to obliterate Christianity in its entirety. So one of the questions that came up was, were times prior to the flood worse than they are today? We have found this extremely difficult to get our heads around, given today's world is a morass of sin and hatred of God. So your thoughts on this would be most interesting. So I guess I can just open up the floor here and see any of our Reverend Fathers would like to take a stab at this question.
Well, Father Skierka looks like he's got...
Well, first off, we don't know, but it must be pretty bad back then. That's okay. What I'd say.
Yeah.
Is it worse than now? Who knows?
Yeah.
Over the years, people thought the world's come to an end because it was so bad. Persecutions, different times. I couldn't... French Revolution, the Protestant Reformation. It's pretty bad. So, you know, is it worse now? Who knows?
Mm-hmm. Okay.
That's my thought.
Yeah. Father Mroczka?
As a priest, I could see that the last 36 years that I've been around in my priestly duties, that things have gotten worse in society in general, and especially since Roe versus Wade and abortions, and then all of the horrible sins committed by the human race, which is going further and further to the left in its progressive views of things, and morality is out the window.
Mm-hmm.
So yes, in a sense, what I think there is a resurgence, almost in my eyes, a resurgence of paganism that has engulfed our country and the world at large, and you can almost sense it among some people. I can't describe it in words, but you go out into airports, bus stations, train stations, and you talk to people in general in the street, and there's a certain sense amongst the people that you get of the dystopia, that they're just, they are the zombie apocalypse, in a sense. That I get that feeling, so.
Mm-hmm.
And just with the... I mean, we can all tell stories. We're all old enough here to tell stories. When I was growing up, fathers were growing up, out in society, if anybody used bad language, for example, publicly, you said, well, watch it, there's women present. Now, of course, that is all out the
not
window.
The
profanity of vulgarity is very commonplace today. In fact, Father and I were in a restaurant in Bismarck, remember that? And we were seated at a table, and there was two girls waiting at the host station to get seated, 20-something, and just spewing out, not caring, one profanity after another, without this total disregard for anybody else's sensibilities.
Yeah.
But it's a reflection, I think, of the modern mentality today, of its abandonment of God, its abandonment of religion and moral practices. So that's why I perceive, and I don't know if you follow it, but...
Well, there's morality, but there's immorality, and there's a difference. You know, people who are immoral are breaking the law of God. Yeah, but they know they're breaking the law of God. They might even feel badly about it, but they do it anyway. But there's amorality, which is the complete absence of any moral principle whatsoever, you know. But I think we're at a stage of anti-morality, where morality, moral principle, is looked upon with disdain, even distrust, as though it is
contempt.
Somehow... contempt, yes. Yeah. It is exactly that. They have a contempt for the moral principles of the past. And I do think it is worse in this one sense. I mean, as Father Skierka says, I mean, in terms of the material sins, the objective matter of the sins, that's one question. But I think this is worse today because you have today a world which rejects Jesus Christ. I mean, the world of Sodom and Gomorrah did not know him.
Mm-hmm.
But the world today knew him, right? And they have rejected him. With an exclamation point, you know.
They despise him.
And they despise him, they detest him, they actually hate him. And I think in that sense, the anti-morality of this day constitutes the great rebellion. And I mean, that's what apostasy is. It's a great rebellion against God. Mm-hmm. And I think that's what we're dealing with. We're dealing with the great apostasy. And I think that... That includes this shrill anti-morality that we're seeing all around us. And I agree with what Father Skierka and Father Mroczka will have to say about that.
Mm-hmm.
But I think that is the factor which makes it so much worse today.
Mm-hmm.
I think the fact also that people are living in this world where those who love our Lord and are faithful to him and want to follow his moral principles... His teachings also have that much more to suffer, or will have that much more to suffer. Remember St. Louis de Montfort said that in the latter days, the saints will be so great that they will be as the cedars of Lebanon compared to shrubs, you know, even compared to the early martyrs of the church.
Mm-hmm.
So there's a certain hatred of Christ that is brewing in the world now that is going to make this sanctity necessary. There can be no lukewarm Catholics, as it were.
Mm-hmm.
Those who are going to hold to the faith, they're going to hold it completely, or they're going to lose it. So I just think it's the times.
And there's actually an increase of, and it's very overt now at the open today, of Satanism.
Yes, definitely.
No question about it. Yeah. And they're very bold about it. And as Father said with St. Louis de Montfort, you know, God, in every age... In every situation, God raises saints up to combat the errors of the day. And we do have the promise of St. Louis de Montfort that in these days, in the latter days, he'll raise up saints probably to equal that of the apostles in the working of miracles.
Really?
So I do have hope for the next generation. And we just had a beautiful dinner for Father Greenville's 30th anniversary.
Sure.
And at the reception I saw here at the Immaculate Conception Church here, at the reception, a plethora of children, which is, you know, they say that the World War II generation was the greatest generation. But I do have hope that this generation, due to the efforts of Father Jenkins, Father Greenwell, and instilling the Catholic faith into the youth, that these will be raised up to be the next greatest generation of the 21st century someday. May history record that they are now the best and greatest, the generation of this century. And that is incumbent upon the people here, and is thanks to the good Father here, and Father Greenwell, because it is just a joy to see youth and the innocence of youth. And you go out today in the world today and you see the hardness, and my Father can tell you, most modern kids today, there's a certain hardness on their face because they do not know God. And what I witness today, and my Father certainly will agree, that what I witness today is the joy and the peace and the countenance of the youth today, and the flower of the youth,
mm-hmm.
that is reflected because they have the Catholic faith. It's a beautiful thing to witness, you know. So I have hope
sure.
for the future in the evils which confront us in the world today.
Sure. Father Skierka, I wanted to go back to something you said. I thought you made an interesting point talking about, you know, how frequently throughout human history We certain people that have thought that we were at the end times. I believe even in the St. Paul's epistles, he references this, where there were those who thought that the end times were upon them even back then. So is there something in human nature that causes us to believe that we're near the end times? Is there something in human nature that causes us to kind of look for the worst and just kind of have this apocalyptical?
I don't know. Look for the worst. You just said maybe they see the worst.
Yeah.
And going back to what Father Jenkins says, they're in rebellion. I don't know if a lot of them aren't in rebellion. They don't even know God. I have had converts over the years. I'd ask them, as a starting point, what religion they belong. What's their religion?
Mm-hmm.
Their answer is usually Christianity.
Yeah, yeah.
And then I'd ask them, well, what's the basis for your Christianity? They said, I believe in God. Yeah. They don't know Christ. They're not in rebellion to Christ. They don't even know Christ.
Yeah.
They don't know who our Lord is, and they're just embraced. They grew up in the world. That's part of their life. And their friends have rebelled. They're rebelling against God. But to ask your question, I don't think it's something in nature. Unless, in fact, it's fallen human nature. We look for the worst, I guess.
Sure, yeah, and I believe, Father Jenkins has said this before, how Pope St. Pius X, he said that even in his time, 100 years ago, that he said Catholics at that time, many Catholics did not even know enough about the Catholic faith to save their soul. That was 100 years ago, well before Roe versus Wade, well before any of
my
the...
people suffer for a lack of knowledge.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. So, could it possibly be any better now than it was in Pope St. Pius's, Pope St. Pius X's day? I mean, are not things clearly much worse now? If there was a lack of knowledge then, what is there today?
Oh, it's worse. If lacking, I mean, lack of knowledge means nothing, mm-hmm. how can you get less than nothing? But it is worse.
Yeah, Well, then I guess the next logical question that would follow from this is what do we do? What can Catholics do in these times? How can you how can we be good Catholic leaders in these times? How can we secure our souls during this time when we see all of this rampant immorality, this anti-morality? What should we be doing in these times?
I'm reading Ephesians here, chapter 6, in the Holy Bible. For wrestling is not against flesh and blood, against the rulers of the world of this darkness, against the spirits of wickedness in high places. Therefore, take unto you the armor of God, that you may be able to resist in the evil day, and to stand in all things perfect. Stand therefore, having your loins girt about with truth, and having on the breastplate of justice, and your feet shod with the preparation of the gospel of peace. In all things, taking the shield of faith, wherewith you may be able to extinguish all the fiery darts of the most wicked one. So that is a warning of St. Paul of the battle of the spiritual combat that we now face. And I do think that we are in a spiritual fight, a spiritual war. Now, what weapons do we have? We have the Blessed Mother Virgin Mary, and of course, the story of St. Dominic. We went to southern France and northern Italy to try to convert the Albigensians, and met with little luck until he went off into the forest, and Our Lady gave him the Most Holy Rosary. This is how you're going to convert souls, is through this means, by this spiritual weapon, the Most Holy Rosary. And he met with great success. The amount of converts that he made and the good that he did is unprecedented. It's amazing. And then one thing I've been trying to promote is a 54-day novena in lieu of what's happening to our country with the riots, the attempt of communism to overthrow the Constitution of the United States, to impose upon this country evil, the evil such as communism, by the Democratic Party and others. Let's call a spade a spade. These Democrats are Marxist communists for the most part. I mean, there's a few that don't toe the party line, but for the most part, the current leadership have Marxist ideology in their hearts and minds. So in order to combat the evil of the day, I've been trying to promote with our people the 54-day novena, which is Father Skierka beautifully reprinted here. And it consists of 27 days of petition, and 27 days of thanksgiving, and for the intention of the conversion of sinners and for the good of our country, the United States of America. So I think we have to employ spiritual means to combat a spiritual problem. The problem is a spiritual combat that we are not engaged in. So we have to use the means available given to us by God, given to us by heaven. And that is through St. Dominic and through the saints down through the ages, by the Queen of the Most Holy Rosary. And Father actually did a very good job of reprinting this pamphlet that was over 100 years old. But in case you're not familiar with it, there's the origin, and this pamphlet does tell you a little about the origin of it and where it came from. And there are some additional prayers in here that a person will recite during this 54-day novena, 27 days of petition, 27 days of thanksgiving.
And the petition is the rosary.
Yeah, and for the intention is for the conversion of sinners and the conversion and the good of our country, the United States. That's what I'm doing it for. I asked our people starting today, as this broadcast is being recorded, September the 1st to start, and you can keep track. Every day you say joyful, sorrowful, and the glorious mysteries, and there's a calendar in the back where you can check off each day, I say, or look on your own calendar and mark off day one, I said the joyful mysteries with the prayers, day two the sorrowful, and then day three the glorious mysteries, and so forth. You hit the 27th day, then you begin the Thanksgiving, since the 54 days. And there's some beautiful meditations in here. There's, like, for the joyful mysteries, for the Annunciation. And there's a sweet and nice little meditation prayer. And then I bind these snow white buds with the petition for the virtue of humility, and humbly lay this bouquet at thy feet. And so, beautiful picture of, by the way, is one of my favorite gospels, is that of the incarnation when the Archangel Gabriel appeared to the Blessed Mother and informed her that she was to be the Mother of God. And Our Lady said, "How shall I have this be since I know not man?" And she was informed by the Archangel Gabriel that the Holy Ghost would overshadow her, and she would conceive and bring forth a son and call his name Jesus. You know, the world waited in anticipation for that particular moment to see what Our Lady's answer would be. And she said those words, "Fiat mihi secundum verbum tuum," let this be done unto me according to thy word. You know, in that instant, the second person of the Blessed Trinity became incarnate in the womb of the Blessed Virgin Mary. God became one of us, took on human flesh. That's the word incarnation comes from the Latin, which means literally to clothe oneself with human flesh. And that is one of the principal mysteries of the Catholic faith, that of the incarnation. We'll never fully understand that. But it's a beautiful, magnificent moment in time, because the supernatural order of heaven and the natural order of earth come together and they touch in a beautiful, magnificent way in the womb of the Blessed Mother. It is beautiful.
And that's where the rosary begins.
That's where the rosary begins. And that's why I think the weapon that we must employ is pray the rosary for the conversion of sinners and for the good of our country. We are under assault today by the forces of evil. There's no question about it. I mean, the politicians want that with the riots and the peaceful protesters. I mean, in Minneapolis, it looks, if you see any pictures of World War II of Dresden, that's how Minneapolis looks, where I'm from. Really?
The rioting came about a mile
from
the church.
A mile from our church.
Yeah.
I mean, Century College had, where a community college a mile away from us, had windows broken. So, I mean, it's in our face. And I think people have to make a decision as to what to do to give them some consolation and hope. Especially to employ the spiritual means to combat a spiritual evil, the forces of evil that are prevalent amongst people.
What would you say to those who say that you know, the state of our country today, it's kind of it's progressed past just a spiritual battle? We have to.
There's always hope. I saw, like I said, I witnessed those kids today, and Father did. That's the future.
Yeah.
And I see a certain beauty, and a certain, you see a piece of soul in somebody. We were priests. I'm not a medical doctor, a psychologist, but I'm able to see someone's countenance shining forth.
Sure.
And I perceived that in that youth, and I said, this hopefully will be the next greatest generation, thanks to people like Father, Father Jenkins.
The children rejoice in good things.
They do.
Not in evil. They rejoice in good.
Goodness.
And that's what Our Lady said. My soul hath rejoiced in God my Savior. Mm-hmm. And it's the very innocence of the children which arms them, for the battle, really. Protecting that innocence. Bishop Sheen said that an evil man is different from a bad man. A bad man profits from doing evil things, bad things. But an evil man seeks to destroy innocence wherever he finds. He rejoices in destroying innocence. And you can see why these children would be targeted by evil. Mm-hmm. But their innocence is a great bulwark, and to protect that innocence is so important. And I was very happy to hear Father Mroczka and Father Skierka point this out, that they saw that there, too.
It's obvious.
Saw it too. Tom, you mentioned the question of whether we look for evil, with past generations seeing the world on the verge of coming to an end. And I mentioned before that, I don't think it's necessarily we're looking for evil, but I do think people have a sense that if the world is so given to sin, that we are tempting God, in a sense. And I think people do have a sense of impending doom if they are presumptuously defying God. So at every time in the world's history where there was a general degradation of the human race in terms of moral principles, I think they would feel that, like we're getting ourselves in trouble, we're really asking for it. Mm-hmm. And for all we know, if it had continued unabated, that God might have terminated everything there. Mm-hmm. But there were saints whom God raised up, as we heard, and they led a resurgence of faith, and so we were on the brink. We were saved, and so we hear today from these two good priests that, there is still plenty of hope out there, because we know that there can be a reaction or a response, not just reaction, but an actual response to the challenges of the day, and actually offer to God the reparation, the prayer, the love that we should give to Him, reparation for the sins committed against Him. And what Father Mroczka is promoting here, this 40 days Rosary Novena, is a very important part of that. So he's saying, as I understand, that this is the response that we have to give to God for the sin that is cast in His face contemptuously every day. And there you have hope, but this is hope that heaven itself sent to us, because
and
this is
so little can do so good, so much.
Yeah, yeah. Where would one get one of these copies of this booklet?
Funny you should ask. Well, I ordered a few hundred from.
We have a limited supply.
But yes,
Father printed them up actually, so you can get more. And I'm sure if they want to write to Father Jenkins
or contact you, if they contacted you through what Catholic
program.
Sure. Should we put Father Mroczka and Father Skierka's addresses there also? For contact?
Yeah,
we need a small donation to cover the cost.
Okay.
It's not a fundraiser, but it's a prayer raiser.
Okay, sounds good, Father. You mentioned this kind of impending sense of doom that we have, and I think that's really evident in the world today. Even with so many of the current movies that come out, it seems that there's this theme of just kind of this constant like apocalyptic theme, end of the world and all of this. So, but would that not be a good thing in a certain sense? If we kind of have this kind of guilt almost that we feel that we are offending God, and we feel this way that we're in trouble because of what we're doing. Would that not hopefully, I guess, kind of spur us to repentance? So could that not be a good thing?
One would only hope, right? Well, we look at 9/11, right? And we see the reaction to that, right? And other disasters, people say, oh, we've got to pray. But they don't change their lives, not for long anyway. But I would hope, as you say, Tom, that just this idea of impending doom would sober people up a bit if it would only make them reform.
their lives.
If they don't have the faith, though, what do they do? I mean,
if they don't have the faith,
as a Catholic, we know we can pray, but what do the rest of the world that don't believe in God, don't know God, mm-hmm. yeah, they have an impending doom, a debilitating doom.
What are they praying to? What are they praying for?
We got to do this for the conversion of sinners, that God moves the most hardened of hearts towards conversion. And that's one of the promises of the Sacred Heart, that God will, our Lord, give to priests the power of conversion of the most hardened of hearts.
Mm-hmm.
So I think especially through the Sacred Heart of Jesus and through the Immaculate Heart of Mary and our devotion to that, let God's grace work upon the people. Mm-hmm. I mean, and we can't give up. I mean, it's with our, I think, obligation and duty as priests to pray for that particular intention. You know? And never underestimate the grace of God. I mean, all of us priests we travel all over the country and even outside the United States, and it's not unusual. All the priests can tell you a story. Bless me, Father, if I have sinned, it's been 50 years since my last confession.
Really? That's great, yeah.
Those things happen, mm-hmm. you know, or someone's on their deathbed and through the, by virtue of receiving the traditional sacraments, they call on the family, they don't think he's going to last through the night. Then 2 years or 3 years later, you're making communion calls to the same person because they beat their cancer for a time. So miracles happen. Mm-hmm. And you can't underestimate the grace of God to move the most hardened of sinners, even in our society today. And I think God's going to draw out, there are conversions happening. Father can attest to that, the fact that due to this program, that he himself has seen where people approach Father Skierka and they want to take convert instructions, or they have saw the program, and they are moved in a special way, and or maybe they're a Protestant, they want to convert to Catholicism, and because of this show. You know? So God's grace, God works in serious ways, surely, and his ways are not our ways. So we have to always remember that. You know?
And a lot of us, too, these people that are interested, you can't say, here's the Bible, read it, because the Bible has no authority as far as they're concerned. So you appeal to the reason, and they see the reasonableness of what you're saying, and then you bring the Bible in, then you turn to prayer, and then they start getting an understanding, a grasp of the whole of an order they never heard of, the spiritual order. Mm-hmm. They don't even never thought of it.
Well, you know, as you say, Father Skierka, you're giving them the reasonable answers. That's really just removing the obstacles in the way.
Right.
So it opens the way up to divine revelation. But you have to do that first.
Absolutely. Because as far as me quoting the Bible, trying to show them there's a true faith, that Bible doesn't mean anything to them. They never read it, never heard of it.
Mm-hmm. Not until... But like St. Augustine, right?
Yeah.
I mean, he's grappled with it for the longest time. He despised it. He thought it was not human wisdom.
And it's through the tears of his mother, St. Monica, mm-hmm. for at least 20 years, prayed for the conversion of her son, St. Augustine, that he was totally lazy. Take up and read.
And you know, Father Rasha, I mean, just when she thought that he had escaped her grasp and run off to Rome, mm-hmm. and then Milano, well, in Milan, who did he meet but St. Ambrose?
Yeah.
And he was the one who overcame the obstacles by, you know, use of reason. He overcame that resistance, and St. Augustine began to see the truth. You know, and that's,
you know, that's one aspect. The other aspect is, look at the early Christians. Look at any period of time of St. Dominic, the Pius X or Pius V. You had all these people saying the rosary. Pius V, one people pay the rosary because of the Muslims invading Europe.
Lepanto.
And so the people started praying. You see the early Christians started doing it, and people says, look what, how they love one another.
Mm-hmm.
We have the same thing now. They say the rosary, and it's going to manifest itself in their own demeanor, in their own conduct, how much they love their belief will come through, and people are going to see that. And it says, certainly not the world, there's something else. And look how happy they are. Even in these terrible times, when we think the bad is Sodom and Gomorrah or whatever period it might be.
And I say, I also, like, some Catholics who are lukewarm, sometimes I hear an objection that, well, I like to say my own prayers. I don't want to pray the rosary. You know? I got to remember something. You know, this comes from Our Lady. This comes from heaven. When it comes to heaven, you kind of hate to say no.
Or say, I can do better.
Yeah.
When it's praying the gospel.
And I think us too, and also have to teach the people how to pray.
Right.
If you can pray in your own words, nothing wrong with making your own prayers up.
Yeah.
You use your prayer books, rosary, you know, litanies, or whatever you want to do, but you have to start a conversation with God, an intimate conversation. And my mother told me one time, she said, you know, your father and I got along great because, you know what, when we put the kids to bed, we could sit down at the kitchen table over a cup of coffee, and we could talk to each other. We could have a conversation. Mm-hmm. So in a certain way, you have to have a conversation with God. And it's sincere. See, prayer is very easy. It's not rocket science. It's nothing more than the uplifting of the mind and the heart to the things of God. You know, and when they brought to our Lord, they said, who's the greatest? And he takes my child. He said, unless you become as one of these little ones, you won't enter into the kingdom of heaven. So to approach our Lord in a childlike fashion with sincerity, confidence, and trust, and perseverance. And talk to him like you would to have an intimate conversation with your wife or with your children. And have a sincere conversation. So what do you do? Acts, acronym, ACTS. We say prayers of adoration. Thank you, Almighty God, for, you know, creating me this day. Contrition or compunction for our sins. I'm sorry for having offended thee. And I said, you know, I thank thee, Almighty God, adoration, I adore thee, Almighty God, ever present in the blessed sacrament. I thank thee, Almighty God, for the benefits I receive, spiritual or temporal. Supplication, I ask God for the favors I am in need of. Mm-hmm. Those are the four ends of prayer. And the highest form of prayer, of course, is the Holy Mass, mm-hmm. of course, because of the infinite value. But the point is, though, I think if people just sit down in the quiet. And believe me, all of us, well, it's great to tell you, I go get gas at the gas station, you hear this blaring music.
Yes.
It's like the modern world does not want you to have peace by yourself alone.
They want to put noise too, because you
noise, constantly.
Pray.
So you're distracted.
You can't concentrate, you can't meditate.
So you got to have some quiet time, you know, quiet time, either in your home or somewhere, in your own privacy, your own room, somewhere where you can have quiet. Mm-hmm. You know, you'll say, you know, I can hear the silence, you know. You go on a retreat, but you have to have that moment where you're able to get yourself in the presence of God in the chapel or wherever, and begin that conversation. You know, here's what I need, Lord. You know, help me.
Then listen,
you know,
the
man in the temple, Lord, have mercy on me, a sinner. You know, the Pharisee and the publican. He said, you know, and the Pharisee's there. I'm not like the rest of these sinners, adulterers. You know, blah blah blah. And all the guy in the back could do is beat his breast and say, I'm sorry for having offended thee. Help me. Yeah? Lord, help me. I need your help. So if you say that in this honest and sincere way, and you surrender yourself to the will of God, you're on the right track. Mm-hmm. That's why we need this.
Sure.
The message is, we have to get, if you read the Old Testament, you read the history of the human race. When the Israelites were bad, God punished them. And when they got on their knees and repented, he favored them again.
Right.
And that's, we must repent. We have offended God, and so we must get on our knees and beg for his forgiveness. That's
mm-hmm. Sure.
I go a lot too much.
You're not sure? In Cincinnati area, we've started what we call the Flash Rosary.
Yes.
Okay. And Tom knows. He's organized this a couple times already. It just started. But parishioners have come forward and said, well, I'll take a Saturday a month. What they do is they just notify everybody at 1 o'clock or so on Saturday afternoon. We'll be praying the rosary downtown Cincinnati in one of the parks or one of the public places. But we're not going to say exactly where yet. We don't reveal the place until maybe an hour or two ahead of time, just to avoid interference, those who might want to make trouble. And so far, it's worked pretty well. I guess Tom, three times, four times?
Yeah. We've had good turnout. We've had great feedback from it. So hopefully we can.
And I can see incorporating something like that together with this, in terms of saying, you know, it's part of your Rosary Novena here, or a 45-day Rosary Novena.
54.
54 days. Sorry. Thank you. This is a good opportunity. Let's get together downtown and have a public Rosary. So I can see that working very well.
Mm-hmm. Sure.
I would encourage others to do that too, wherever you are in the country.
Yeah, absolutely. Well, I guess in the couple of minutes we have left, I wanted Father Skierka to go back to something you said. You mentioned Sodom and Gomorrah. You know, we talked a bit about that before the program started, and you know how terrible things were there, obviously, and yet God said that to Abraham. He said that he would have spared Sodom and Gomorrah had he found 10 just men there. Right, yeah. And so do you think that we could expect the same from God today?
Absolutely. Yeah. God doesn't change.
Yeah, yeah.
You know, if he gets, and I said the same thing. The reason I think our country's not been destroyed, the world's not been destroyed, we have some good people out there. Good people out there praying. I think another thing, aside from even that, mere fact that our public leaders, Trump, for example, he says, I think the quote was, he said, we stand to the flag and we genuflect or kneel to God. Mere fact that a public figure would proclaim that, we had never heard that.
Every human being is made in the image and likeness of God.
The born and the unborn. So that's...
So the Republican National Convention closed with the Ave Maria.
Right. But that alone means it is a big thing.
Yeah.
That our public officials would do that.
Yeah.
But in conjunction with that, now we got to back it up too by praying. And once again, yes, you can change things around. And I think, once again, it's not as bad as it is because we have good people out there praying. I'm convinced of it. Otherwise, what's to stop God from... God should punish the world.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, it's strange that dichotomy because there is so much evil out there.
Yes.
I mean, it's just horrendous to see. But at the same token, there's so much good out there. And like we witnessed it today at the dinner, you know, and for the Mass for Father. And so, and that's what gives me hope.
Yeah.
Because I see it in people who love God, want to save their souls, and want to get to heaven. You know, and it's a beautiful thing to witness. So there's hope for me in that, you know. So.
Well, I believe there's hope for you, too. I'm glad to say.
But, you know, when I was first ordained, people would say, I couldn't imagine bringing kids into the world, having kids and being married,
yes,
having children,
yes,
at this day and age.
Yes.
You know, back in 1980 and 82 and 84, now we have children of those children bringing their children into the world now. And they could probably be saying the same thing.
Yes.
But, you know, they're going to... Mm-hmm.
Yeah, we've actually received that very question to our program here. We've had people email in and ask, you know, with the state of the world today, do you think that it's justifiable to bring children into
Absolutely.
The world?
Absolutely, we need it.
Well, Father Skierka's own mother had a hand in bringing 100 something great grandchildren to the world. Right?
105.
105.
Wow.
She's over 100 years of age.
She
born March 2nd.
Like March 2nd. Yeah.
Yeah. Oh. So she's 100 plus years.
But people have to realize that. The whole world realized that why would you not want to bring a child to the world? Why would someone not want to? It's not for this world, it's for heaven. I mean, why would someone say, well, I don't want to have a child that we even have a possibility of going to heaven? Mm-hmm. Why would someone even think of such a thing? That have children, they're destined for heaven. If they're martyrs...
Even when life matters, like your mother, how many is she responsible for generations?
Like, I go back to my grandmother. If my grandmother would have had an abortion, my mother, or used birth prevention of some sort or another, not just 105 children, go another 3 or 4 generations, you're having thousands, 10,000, 20,000, who would not even exist today.
Yeah.
They couldn't even say, I exist. It wouldn't be there. I had the funeral last week for my mother. There was close to 100 some relatives.
Yeah.
Can you imagine if one life matters. And we have to realize that because it's this life that's alive that there is hope. They're destined for heaven.
Yeah, so. A host of grandchildren, great-grandchildren, and then you said if they multiplied that out...
If you take my grandmother, my mother had 105 grandchildren. So let's say it averages out, let's say 5 children per child, because some could get married, some can have children, some get priests, become priests.
Sure.
So if each one of you average out for those 100 kids... Times 5, that's 500. Next generation.
Yeah.
Following generation is 2,500. But if you go 7, that's 700. Next generation is almost 5,000. That's a small town.
Yeah.
Within 100 years.
And they all have the same last name?
Not quite.
Maybe not quite.
Not quite.
But no, it's...
That point well taken, though.
Yeah.
But
each life does matter.
But all these lives matter because all the evil in the world... But. Okay, so they're martyred, they're, you know, put to death, wherever it might be. They're destined for heaven. So someone who's conceived even, they can say, I exist. They know God naturally. But someone who's even prevented from existing can't even know God even naturally. Can't know of God. He doesn't even exist. He's non-existent. I coined a term. What was the term I coined? I forget. basically, in other words, not only just killing the innocent, it's preventing the innocent from even existing.
Sure.
How sad is that? How evil is that?
Yeah.
Some to think that there's only two children or one child. This race for suicide, do something like that, or suicide of the race.
Absolutely. Yeah.
Well, there's a great contempt for life, because it's a great contempt for the life giver. It's a great contempt for the creator. It all comes back to that.
They forgot what we exist for, what we're created for.
That's right.
I will not serve.
Yeah.
Yep. There you are. Yeah. By the way, I want to point something out. Father Mroczka, you mentioned that you're starting this on September 1st.
Which is today.
Yeah.
But those
who get this book later than that, we have magnificent feast days coming up. We go to September 8th,
right.
The birthday of Our Lady.
Right.
The 12th of September, the Holy Name of Mary.
Absolutely.
The 15th, Our Lady of Sorrows.
Absolutely.
Sorrows
of anytime you want to start.
The 24th of September, Our Lady of Ransom. So you can start on any of those days.
A lot of feast days just come in honor of Our Lady.
I think Our Lady of Ransom would be a good feast day.
We've
got to ransom mankind.
Very good to start.
Wow.
Beautiful feast days in
October 7th,
of Our Lady.
October 11th.
Yes.
Yeah. Yes, yeah, so any day is fine as long as you do it.
That's where you start.
It's just that. Yeah. I did it. Our parish did it on January 1st, and then I said, well, before the election, I'd like to start again being September 1st, so that's why I'm doing it. But hey, out there, anytime you want to start, it's fine. You know, just do it. That's the point.
They've also started rosary walks here.
Yes.
Where at certain evenings during the week, some of the families will get together in neighborhoods and just walk around the sidewalks.
Yep.
And across the way, one of the families did that the first time. They had 100 people. About 100 people show up, actually.
Wow.
Take part in the rosary walk.
Yeah.
They're doing it on a certain night every week.
And then what's that they refer to as living rosary now that people are
signing
up
to? They're getting up going too.
Yeah.
So there's fidelity. So there's a lot of activity out there, a lot of praying that is, you know, rising to heaven right now. I mean, heaven knows we need it. So.
Sure, absolutely.
Yeah, as I say, it's a spiritual combat, a spiritual war we're engaged in. So we have to use spiritual means to combat a spiritual problem.
Mm-hmm.
And this is one of the ways I do it.
Mm-hmm. And you know, I guess in closing, you know, if it's a spiritual warfare, certainly the greatest spiritual arms that we have is the Mass. And I just read today in the Hidden Treasure book by St. Leonard of Port Maurice, I believe he called the Holy Sacrifice of the Mass the potent prop that is holding the world up from falling into the abyss of its sins. And so
Andre Pio says you can do better without the sun.
Yeah.
And without the Holy Sacrifice of the Mass.
Yeah. And obviously, we wouldn't have the Mass without our priests, so I thank you all very much, very much for that. And thank you for everything that you do. And thank you all for being here tonight. It's been great to have you on the show.
My pleasure.
Yeah.
Well, Tom, thank you too.
Yeah.
Thank you,
good Catholic layman, to keep moving forward here by the grace of God. And
we'll have to do it again.
Bring in little children in the world. Right? Yeah.
We'll have to do it again, right?
Let's do it again.
That's right. Yeah. That's right. Sounds good. All right. Well, thank you, Reverend Fathers. I appreciate your time. God bless you all. Yeah.
Thank you.
God bless.
Thanks to all of our viewers as well for watching this episode of What Catholics Believe. Until next time, we ask that you all remember the words of Our Lady at Fatima to consecrate yourselves and your families to the Immaculate Heart of Mary and to pray and do penance. Thank you, and God bless you.